Reversing any aspect of cellular aging in any organism is extremely hard. So it's very exciting that we've now reversed cellular aging in mice, which has restored their vision. A team of scientists at Harvard Medical School, including two PhDs, David Sinclair and Wan-Ching Liu, managed to restore vision and reverse cellular aging in eye tissue in mice using cellular reprogramming. We'll have this story plus other stories in this episode of Lifespan News. Welcome to Lifespan News, your source for longevity science updates. I'm your host, Brent Nally. If you missed our last episode, then you can watch it by clicking the card above. We encourage you to check the description below for links to these stories. Lifespan News is part of Life X10 Show, or X10 for short. This is the last episode of Lifespan News here on Leaf's YouTube channel. Our next episode will be on X10's own YouTube channel on January 5th, 2021. So this is also the last episode of 2020. We encourage you to subscribe to the new X10 YouTube channel by clicking the card above. You can also find a link in the description below. Once you're subscribed, be sure to click the notification bell and select all notifications to ensure you don't miss any videos. And while you're there, be sure to check out X10's new channel trailer. For our first story, reversing cellular age in mice restores their vision. The research team used a viral vector to deliver three of four chemicals known as Yamanaka factors into the eye of adult mice suffering from optic nerve injury. Exposure to Yamanaka factors is known to cause the epigenetic profile of cells to revert to a younger state. The treatment had the effect of increasing the number of cells surviving the injury and produce five-fold increase in optic nerve regrowth. Following this success, the researchers tried to see whether the same approach could restore vision lost to glaucoma and even normal aging. In both cases, the treatment was able to restore vision and make their optic nerve cells behave similarly to those of young mice. This work could pave the way for treatments to restore vision without invasive procedures like retinal transplants, although the researchers cautioned that further animal studies will be necessary before moving on to human trials. For our next story, University of California, San Francisco scientists discovered that an experimental drug called ISRIB can reverse cognitive aging in mice. ISRIB stands for Integrated Stress Response Inhibitor. Indeed, the drug works by inhibiting a cellular stress response mechanisms called ISRIB. ISRIB reacts to stressors such as viral infections or carcinogenic mutations by halting protein production inside cells. While this is a critical mechanism to prevent potential dangerous cells from proliferating, it can be problematic if it's active all the time for no reason. Previous research showed that ISRIB was able to restore the cognitive abilities of animals who suffered from traumatic brain injury. Given that this type of injury resembles in many ways an accelerated age-related cognitive decline, the researchers wondered if ISRIB could reverse aspects of brain aging. To figure that out, the researchers trained aged mice for 3 days to escape from a watery maze by finding a hidden platform. This task is typically hard for old mice, but those among them who had received small doses of ISRIB performed just as well as young mice, unlike the old controls who weren't treated and struggled as expected. The treated old mice kept from performing like young mice every day for 3 weeks after treatment, despite being placed in a different maze every time. According to the researchers' analysis, a single dose of ISRIB was enough to make the mice's neurons become quickly more sensitive to stimulation and form more stable and robust connections with the neighboring cells. This is something typically observed only in young mice. ISRIB also seems to positively affect immune cells known as T cells, which are themselves prone to age-related decay. Overall, this study suggests that cognitive decline may not be a one-way process, but rather a reversible condition. This study is open access, and as always, we'll have a link in the description below. Moving on, a key gene links diet and longevity. A key gene mediating the effect of dietary restrictions on longevity has been identified, improving our understanding of the link between the two and raising the prospect of more targeted therapeutic interventions. Dietary restriction is one of the most reliable ways to increase longevity, increasing lifespan in species from fruit flies to rodents. Researchers at the Max Planck Institute for Biology of Aging have shown that the sestrin-1 gene plays a key role in this. The team engineered a version of sestrin with a mutation in the amino acid binding region, preventing it from acting as an amino acid sensor. When cells starved of amino acids were fed the amino acid leucine, genes downstream of TORC1 or TORC1 were only activated if the cells had normal sestrin, not the mutated version. So in other words, sestrin is a key amino acid sensor for the TORC1 pathway. TORC1 is part of the IGF-TOR nutrient sensing network linking dietary restriction and longevity. The researchers followed up with in vivo tests and found that flies with the mutated form of sestrin didn't live longer on a restricted diet. Still, even more interesting, the mutant flies lived even longer than ordinary flies on a high-protein diet. But that was mainly due to the low survival of wild-type flies. Therefore, it seems that sestrin not only mediates the nutrient detection that makes dietary restriction beneficial, but may also protect against the harmful effects of a protein-rich diet. There still isn't good evidence that dietary restriction increases lifespan in humans, and even if there were, many people have trouble keeping to a restricted diet, or might not be able to for medical reasons. So finding other ways to achieve the same effect seems like a promising path forward, and sestrin provides one more tool with which to forge that path. For our next story, kidney progenitor cells derived from urine have therapeutic potential. Researchers from Heinrich Heine University Düsseldorf in Germany have determined that kidney progenitor cells secreted in urine have therapeutic potential and might be used for kidney regeneration. Kidney transplants are among the most frequent of all transplants, both because donors are easier to find and because chronic kidney disease is common during aging. However, like all organ transplants, this kind of procedure isn't risk-free, both for the donor and the recipient, the latter probably having to put up with complications due to immune rejection and immunosuppression treatments. For these reasons, researchers have long sought to regrow kidneys using progenitor cells harvested from the patients themselves, but normal procedures to source the tissues are invasive and potentially detrimental to the source tissues. In their new study, Heine University scientists collected urine samples from donors between 10 and 61 years of age and isolated kidney progenitor cells from them. The researchers showed that harvested cells were healthy and had not simply been discarded in urine. The cells exhibited kidney-specific markers, and the cells proved able to replicate to produce hundreds of millions of similar healthy cells. Interestingly, further differentiation studies proved that the same cells could also turn into different types of cells. We're not yet at the point where we could grow kidneys from these cells, but this is certainly a step in the right direction. For our final story, memory loss associated with Alzheimer's disease may be able to be restored through epigenetic alterations. According to a preclinical study by researchers at the University at Buffalo, memory loss associated with Alzheimer's disease may be able to be restored by inhibiting certain enzymes involved in abnormal gene transcription. The research team looked at epigenetic changes in postmortem tissue samples from the prefrontal cortex of Alzheimer's patients. The researchers found higher levels of a specific methylation, which is an epigenetic change that activates gene expression. So the researchers then gave an inhibitor of this methylation to mice that are commonly used as a model for Alzheimer's. The researchers found that this improved the mice's prefrontal cortex function and memory-related behaviors. Next, the researchers checked which genes were no longer being upregulated in the mice getting the inhibitor. The researchers found a list of genes which normally increase because of the methylation, but weren't going up because of the inhibitor. The top-ranked gene in their list was SGK1. SGK1 was linked with a lot of other genes on the list and is also involved in other neurodegenerative diseases, including Parkinson's disease and amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, or ALS. When the researchers directly inhibited SGK1 in mice, they found a significant reduction of hyperphosphorylated tau in frontal cortex and improved memory performance. So, in this study, we have found that administration of a specific SGK1 inhibitor significantly reduces the dysregulated form of tau protein, that is a pathological hallmark of Alzheimer's disease, restores prefrontal cortical synaptic function, and mitigates memory deficits in an Alzheimer's disease model. This, according to Zhen Yan, the study's senior author. Finally, these results have identified SGK1 as a potential key target for therapeutic intervention of Alzheimer's disease, which may have specific and precise effects. That's all the news for our last episode of Lifespan News on Leaf's YouTube channel and for 2020. Before you go, there's a few quick, free, and simple things that you can do to help us solve the human aging problem. If you haven't already, please like this video, share this video on your social media, let us know what you think in the comments below. Also, if you haven't already, please make sure that you're subscribed and you have the notification bell turned to all notifications for Leaf's YouTube channel and for X10's YouTube channel. We really appreciate it, and we look forward to seeing you in the next video, at least as healthy as you are now.